This video is all about white paint and how I use it within my realistic watercolour wildlife paintings. Hello, I'm Paul Hopkinson, a professional watercolour artist with a keen interest in anything to do with wildlife. I teach my realistic painting style both here on YouTube and also within my online school. I know that using white paint can be controversial, but I for one use it a lot. I think it makes a big difference to my work as well. In this video, I show you how I apply it to a study I completed of a delightful robin. I use an opaque white watercolour paint, and I usually begin with it to a creamy consistency. Now the thing with white is that you don't want to apply it in thick lines. It would look odd and not at all realistic. So, think about how you load your brush. Load it with paint, roll it as you come out of the palette, and dab it on some kitchen roll. This will remove any excess paint and water and should give you a fine tip to work with. I'm going to use the white on top of the darker detail that I've already applied. As I have it to a creamy consistency, it will look quite bright to begin with. However, as it dries, the brightness will lessen a bit and it will become much duller in tone. This will look much better and will be more in keeping with the effect I'm trying to create. I want the robin to look as similar to the reference photograph as I can make it. Whites can be very versatile as a colour. Whilst I'm working with a creamy consistency at the moment, if I added more water to my mix, it would instantly produce white lines which are already duller and less bright. Now this can be really useful if you want a touch of paleness in an area rather than a stark white. The other thing to note is that white paints from different manufacturers do vary. I've always used an opaque white from SAA, however, they have recently changed their formula and the white is no longer as opaque as it used to be. Whenever you buy a new white, and indeed any new paint, it's always worth testing it first, before you commit to using it on your painting. I was surprised as anyone that a manufacturer would change their formulation, but clearly it does happen. Now if you're lucky enough to belong to a local art club or group, this would be a great place to try different colours and brands. Every member will have different paints within their kit, and it would be an opportunity to do a swap with somebody and try something new. I actually have a video here on YouTube where I've tested various white paints. I'll pop a link to it on a card in the top right hand corner for you. You may find it useful and it may give you some ideas on the sorts of properties that are important to look for with a new paint as well. Now you can see already I'm beginning to build up a patch of white on the robin, which is looking like the reference photograph. I've been applying lots of fine lines, but rather than applying them as parallel marks, I'm instead thinking about them in a different way. I'm overlapping them, I'm varying the length and the thickness, and I'm also painting some of them slightly curved as well. All these small variations between the lines give the effect of real feathers, all laying on top of one another. I've noticed that some people find it difficult to maintain the vibrancy of the white paint, and this is often because they have added too much water to the mix. As you can see, I'm going over and over the same area with multiple brush strokes. But because the paint I'm using is really creamy in consistency, it's drying quickly, and it isn't blending and merging when the brush goes over it again. If I was doing this with a more watery or milky mix, the layers would merge, and the repeated working of the brush over the surface is eventually going to disturb the colours underneath and muddy them as well. Another thing which you can do with white is overlay it. So when the layer you're working on is completely dry, there's an opportunity to either go over it again with more white paint, and this is really useful if you've had your mix too thin in the first place, and have ended up with white areas that aren't quite bright enough. The addition of the second layer of the same paint will intensify the whiteness and will lift the colour significantly. Now the other thing you can do is overlay a completely dry layer of white with a different colour. Use a watery mix of your chosen colour and apply it lightly in a single pass of the brush over the white. Overlaying colour like this can work really well. To see the effects, head to the video I've linked to in the top right hand corner. It shows me using this technique with a blue tint I'm painting, and adding the yellow over the white works really well on it as well. You can see as I work around this area of white that I'm, well, if you pardon the pun, feathering the white out into the surrounding feathers. So I'm not stopping the white detail along the line between the brown and the orange. Instead, I'm using it to sort of bridge the gap. It's joining the two areas of feathers together, creating a sort of feather blend between the two of them. Along the same lines, and with any colour I'm working with, I very often introduce a touch of that colour into a neighbouring area. So a few little lines of white, applied in areas that don't particularly look white, will have the effect of pulling the whole painting together. It sort of makes each colour work with the other, and ensures the changeover between them isn't too harsh or sudden. Now this can look perfectly fine in a photograph, but in a painting it can actually look a little bit odd. I find the painting seems much more realistic and believable when I use this technique. Now, if you don't get on with watercolour white, then a good water-based alternative would be white gouache. It's also opaque and a good substitute as well. You could of course endeavour to reserve the white of the paper, but I think you can see from the number of crisscross lines I've already applied in this area, that would be a very, very difficult thing to do. I've now switched to an even thicker white, so virtually straight out of the tube. I'm using this for the whiter line that you can see within the photograph, on the edge of the wing. I want this to kind of stand out from the other white that I've applied, so even within a whole patch of white feathers, there can be a huge range of tones that you can create, either by varying the density of the number of lines that you apply on top of one another, or by varying the consistency of the paint. I'm continuing to brighten some of the feathers I've already added. I'm able to do that now that the majority are pretty much dry. This is something I would always advise you to wait for. It's also easy to go in with the white and let it run away with you. Believe me, I've done it. I tend to say that less is always best, so err on the side of caution and apply far less than you think you'll need. Allow it to dry completely and take yourself away from the painting. When you come back with fresh eyes, you'll be in a much better position to be able to assess the white and then decide whether you need more or not. Now that I'm starting to apply the feathers, that'll be at the forefront of this painting. I'm having to be even more careful about loading my brush and ensuring that I'm working with a fine tip and a semi-loaded rather than overloaded brush. The lines need to be as fine as possible. At the same time, areas of detail that you've worked on previously with your other colours, the browns and the oranges, need to still show through. You need to be able to see all those subtle changes of tone underneath the last layer of white, and that is so, so important. If you've enjoyed seeing me paint this robin and found it useful, please leave me a comment. For each comment, YouTube will share my video with more people, and that helps my little channel grow. If you're interested in painting the whole robin, you will find the first part of a completely free tutorial in the top right corner of your screen now. I'll see you there.